Basically, first thing we're going to talk about, and I'm going to do a demonstration of all these at the end. So I'm just going to go give a brief overview of what the commands are, then show you how we utilize them, is open profiles. You'll see these used a lot for in our modeling practices, just because we don't have a hard defined edge. Because with the CAS model, we have a lot of rounded surfaces, toruses, cylinders, and things like that. So with an open profile, you only have to construct the basic geometry of what you're wanting, and then the lines will extend linearly out, and the arcs will extend radially out until they actually run into the geometry themselves. So when you're adding material, you can do this to add material that will go to a boundary that's a varying shape that might not be easy to constrain or to include geometry in, such as when you're going up against the edge of a torus or a cylinder or something like that, and you don't want it to go past the outside wall, but you want it to be able to fill up to that outside wall that is actually a varying shape as it goes up. When you're removing material, it's also nice for the fact that when you create this open profile, as I showed here in this example of these three pictures, is on the left you see the open profile of just a single line that I'm wanting to mill off this pad. Well, they made a casting change that really didn't affect this version of the machining. They added a cast boss onto the side of there. Well, if I had done it originally as a closed profile and done a rectangle around the side of it, well, it would have left that cast boss sitting out in space when I updated my machining. But by utilizing open profile, it will cut away all the material in that direction until it's basically gone beyond that material. So it will cut to that side until it goes outside of the material. It's basically like utilizing through next for your extents options with extrusions and cutouts. Another thing we're going to be talking about is offset faces. With a casting model, you usually are designing what you want your final machine state to be at when you're designing it, because that's what you're going to be utilizing in your final assembly and in your manufacturing. They don't care what the cast surface is, they want to know what the final machine surface is. So when you're designing it, you're designing it to that machine value. To add stock to that, you need for your castings, because a casting is never perfect and you need the machine material way to get your finished face. The foundry and your pattern makers will have to add a certain amount of stock. So, and depending on what foundry you go to, what pattern maker you go to, depends on how much stock they're going to add. So what you can do is you can design your model to the actual machine value, and you could either take your dimensions and then do the math and add the stock into it, or you can use the offset face command, and what you can do is select your machine faces at the machine value, specify your stock value, and then offset those faces to that stock value. So that basically gives you two features, one with your machine value dimension and one with your stock variance value, and that way you can have them separate in your model tree and you don't have to worry about the math and making mistakes in your math when you're creating the part there. The other thing we'll be discussing is family of parts that can both benefit both cast and machine part design. I don't know about you guys, but a lot of times our castings can use the same set of pattern equipment, but they'll have a second core, which are small changes to the casting that is different to the pattern that makes another casting. So that way you don't have to purchase two full sets of pattern equipment to make something that's just slightly varying in size, such as the main bore size of the cylinder is smaller or larger. You would have possibly a different core. Well, you could do that by taking two PAR files and just saving a copy of it and changing the value in there. But if you do that, then you're going to come into the future where, well, if the pattern changes, say you have to change some of the radial values on the outside body of the feature. Well, if you change it in one, well, then you have to go and change it in the second part because it's using the same pattern equipment. But if you use a family of parts and create your base model and then change just the value of the main bore, then you're linking back to one part, and then allows you to have a master part that you can make those changes to your apparent part and have it propagate out to each one of the different castings. So that way you have true casting models with the actual sizes you want, but it's all controlled by one file where you make the changes. So it reduces risks of errors and things like that. Same thing comes about with machinery. A lot of times you'll have a casting that can have multiple configurations of how it's machined. So you can even take a machine model and do the same thing, have a parent part and then have your different configurations of machining, such as quantity of holes or the bolting pattern and things like that, or even one thing, a boss is milled on one part and it's not milled on the other part. So you can control things like that. So you can control dimensional values, and you can also control the suppression and unsuppression of features. We utilize a lot of part copies. A part copy allows you to insert an associative or non-associative copy of a part or assembly into a current part file. So what we utilize a lot is we will create our casting part, and then we'll open up a new part file and insert that casting as a part copy into that file, and then create all of our machine features just as if we had done it out in the shop. That way we can machine off that material just like they would do in machine steps out the shop. So it allows you to see how they're going to actually be machining your part and help you design better and seeing if it's possible to machine. So you're just not creating a model and saying, well, it might be machinable out in the shop, it might not. But if you're actually seeing how they would possibly machine it, it helps you better understand that process. It also comes back to the fact that if you need to make a casting change, you make a casting change to your parent part, and by having that associative part copy link, when you open your machining, it will bring those changes from your casting automatically into your machining part. So it saves the time of being able to create changes in one location and have those changes move over into the other part. The last thing we'll be going over is assembly features. Well, what you can do with assembly features is basically allows you to have a casting that actually turns into more than one part. Like the example up here, we have this rod, connecting rod, that is actually one forging that then we take out to the shop, do some pre-machining to it, then we saw it in half and put them back together and do final machining. So they're a mated pair of parts so that you have a true bore and things like that. So you can do that all in part files, but it requires making multiple copies of the part, and then you have multiple locations you have to go to change for all the features there. So I'll show you how you can use an assembly feature to actually create machine parts within that assembly environment. And this is also, this, we've been doing this a lot when we've been just now moved to ST5. So some of this stuff with assembly features you can now accomplish with multi-bodies. But you'll see from this part that I show, it's still beneficial to use assembly features just for the fact that you get to use assembly relationships to move the various parts together where you don't have the assembly relationships available to you in multi-body. So we're just gonna bring up Solid Edge. We're gonna show you some demonstrations, which I always find a little more entertaining than sitting there reading a PowerPoint presentation. So let's see what I have. I shrunk my window down. All right, so first thing I'm going to do is inside this part. You'll notice that you will have these pads inside this part. And basically what we did here is use an open profile to allow the pad as it goes up to extrude and blend into that external wall of that cylinder. Because as you notice, the outside of that cylinder body is not the same size as it goes up and it doesn't actually go through. So what we're going to do is actually, I'll show you real quick how I drew that in the profile. And the function key doesn't work the same as control on the laptop. Sorry about that. I don't usually use a laptop, so getting used to the laptop keyboard is still foreign to me sometimes. All Okay, we're gonna do an extrusion. I already have an angled plane set up here, and we're gonna do it from the center of the part because I haven't created my internal features yet. One of the things we do is when we design the cylinders, we start from the outside and then make the solid body and then start cutting the features away from the inside. That way, since the majority of our features are symmetrical, we can take them from the center and extrude them out symmetrically and get them on both sides and don't have to worry about recutting out the material in the middle because we haven't cut that yet. So as we go farther along the part, we'll actually cut that material. See inside the part there a little bit. So we're just gonna draw this valve pad. Basically, just a rough sketch like that. You'll notice I'm not including anything out here because what this is gonna do is it's gonna allow that line to extend until it actually intersects the part and then it stops. So it won't actually extend beyond that point outside of the part. So we'll go ahead and put some dimensions on this real quick. And if you didn't know smart dimension, all you do is hit A and it changes from a linear dimension to an angular dimension. Start in solid edge when they're working with closed profiles, they get ingrained into them that you want to have fully constrained profiles. You want everything to be black when you're done. But when you're working with open profiles, you don't have to fully constrain them because those lines are actually still going to be moving on you as the part moves. So as long as they're within the geometry boundary, so I mean, we could put a dimension here to constrain it there so that they maintain within the boundary. But the majority of the time, you know pretty much how big or small your part's going to grow, so you don't really have to constrain the endpoints of those lines because it's gonna work for you. So after you do that, we're just gonna extrude. And when you do an open profile, the nice thing is it asks you which direction you wanna add the material. So basically, you can have the material added on the outside of that profile, or you can have it added on the inside. So we're gonna have it bring it on the inside because we're creating a pad. And then we're gonna go to a symmetric extent. And basically, we're gonna have that at 18.875. And as you see through there in the wireframe, it's created that pad that falls along that line there. At least I hope you can see it that on the screen there, that moves around there and then reaches that wall and then goes up. So it doesn't actually protrude on beyond those surfaces when you've created, but it actually creates it flush with that surface. Another place where we use open profiles a lot is within the rib command. And what you do there, is because we're going to have a rib that goes in between these pads and goes up to the top of that part. But if you were to draw a rectangle and to extrude it out there, it kind of makes it more difficult because you have a lot of varying shapes as it's going across through there. So what you can utilize is the rib command, which is underneath your solids and underneath of fin wall. And we're going to do a rib, and basically we're going to take from our right plane to a parallel plane, and we're going to start that rib at 5 inches over. So it brings us in here, and all I'm going to do for that rib, I'm going to take a single line, go there, and it's going to take another horizontal vertical relationship from the endpoint of that line to the center of the part. And you'll notice that I'm not actually going to the center or to the endpoints of those lines. I use the shortcut keys a lot when I'm working with the geometry. I don't know if everybody's heard of the acronym MICE, which stands for midpoint, intersection, center, and endpoint. And what it is the first letter of each one of those commands. When you're hovering over a line or something like that, if you hit E on your keyboard, it goes to the closest endpoint. If you hit M, it goes to the closest midpoint. If you're hovering over a circle and hit C, it goes to the center of the circle. And the same thing with intersection. So it really makes it nice when you're working on small geometry and you have other things around the endpoint. You just go to the line and hit E and it goes to the endpoint. That way you don't have to worry about everything else in that geometry. So for this grid, all I did was just drew that small line there. Didn't even have to put any dimensions on it. And it's going to ask me first what my thickness of the rib is going to be. I'm going to do an inch and a half inch thick rib. And then you'll see there, you have the arrow wanting to know what direction it wants to go. Well, I want it to go back this way towards the edge of the cylinder body there and have it fill in. And then what we'll do is we'll cut another section here to see that a little better. Notice that rib filled in and followed the curve of the back of that cylinder and filled in there. And as you notice there on the bottom of the valve pads, it filled in and meshed along the bottom of both of those valve pads there. So it makes it really easy to make complex areas fill in by just utilizing these open profiles so that you don't have to worry about all the includes and things like that. And it also makes it easier when you're updating. Because you don't have those includes, if those boundary geometry changes, your profiles go and attach and go with it. Now, what we're going to show here is how to, like we saw in that slide presentation of doing the cut, we have that same machine pad out there, cast box out there on the side of this part. So what we're going to do is go ahead and cut that off. And what I'll do is I'll go from the center of the part, and just because a lot of our stuff is basically symmetrical about it, we start it so that our parts are based around the center of the part is at the center of the base planes. So that way we can take stuff and go off of our base planes and go out symmetrically about it to pull those features. So I'll come out here, and basically all we're going to do for that cut is we're going to do a single line. Now the important part about this is you'll notice I drew that line within the actual material itself. If I extend this line so that it's out here, the problem you'll run into is that line continues until it exits the geometry. But it's already outside the geometry, so what it's going to do is it's going to come up to beyond here and intersect with this geometry and try to go through there. So by maintaining that geometry, the line within my geometry, it's going to stop when it exits out of this pad. So that way it won't actually cut anything but that pad. So if I make a line longer, it's going to cut into other features. So that's an important thing to remember when you're doing open profiles, is the lines stop once they exit the geometry. So if you have it out in open space, it's going to continue on until it meets the next set of geometry and goes through it and stops. So what we're going to do here is I could either dimension it from this pad back, which would basically just be how much cast stock I had on there. But actually, the way they're going to check this out, our machine shop at least, is they're going to say from the center of the part out is how far. So basically, we want to dimension it the same way that we machine it out in the shop. That way, if we make a change to the casting and update it, say we had to change the thickness of the stock here, which is 3/16 over to a quarter inch. Well, if we had dimensioned that 3/16 off of that front face and updated it, well, it would have the wrong machining dimension on it now because the stock changed. So if we, depending on how you dimension it, depends on how robust and easy it is for you to update in the future and maintain your design integrity of what you're wanting to do. So we're just gonna put this at 16 1/4. And that's all I'm gonna do there because I've got my line there. If you know this is gonna be changing a lot, you'll wanna dimension your line so that it will always stay within the part. But I don't want to actually connect it to that line because if I drastically change the geometry, I don't want relationships and things to fail on me and have to go back and edit them. So, I mean, you can connect them there, but if you put dimensions there, it would be better to control it that way so that you don't have to go back and edit it in the future and it becomes more dynamic when you update the part. So we're just gonna accept that and basically ask this again, which direction you wanna cut the material away. You wanna cut outside. And basically what we're going to do is do through next, come in here and tell it both directions. Basically cut my pad there. And so what we're gonna do is I'm gonna, edit my casting. And I'm gonna change that protrusion so that instead of being 32 1/2, I'm going to change it to 33. But we still want to maintain that same thickness on our machining, but say we have another machine model that's going to be using this that has a slightly different dimension there. So I made that one change there. Come back to my machining. And will ask me to update because this is a part copy, which I'm gonna show you here in a minute, but you'll see I use a lot of part copies and things like that as I go through the presentation. And you'll see when it updated, if I pull a dimension here, it still maintained it at 16 1/4. Since I'm gonna get an angle every time I click. You get the idea there. So it basically allows it to update and maintain, and it still cleared that pad off. And even if I came back in here and quickly added a new solid onto this, so I come here, we're adding a new boss there, new boss there, come out. We've got these new bosses that we designed there, which is not actually part of that geometry. And if we had done an include and made a rectangle there, it wouldn't have included that. But by using that open profile, you'll notice that it cut that new material off of there also. So there you see some of the benefits of open profiles. As we go along, you'll see me using those a lot. The next thing I'm going to show here is offset faces. So I have this basic rough cylinder design here, and basically this face here on the top is milled. Part of this face here is milled. These pads are milled. The inside bore is bored out. This end face is milled, and we do some cuts on these faces. So we show the foundry our rough design, and they come back and tell us, well, we're gonna have 3/16 stock on all the surfaces that are machined. Okay. Well, we don't wanna go back through and have to change all of our dimensions and make sure we add that in there. So what we're gonna do is, there it is. Underneath the modify, usually on your solid edge screen at your desk, most of this stuff will be collapsed down into these little drop downs. But the screen is so collapsed, the work on the projector, it kind of makes you worry about drop downs. It's underneath the modify group, and you have offset faces. And you have the ability to do chain, V feature, body, and face. Well, if we do feature or body, the problem is we're going to run into some of the faces aren't going to be offset because they want to stay at the true cast size. Because as you see here, we could choose that. We want the top face to offset, but we don't want the side. So instead, we're going to use face, and we'll just go through here and select all of our machine faces. And we can even include the inside bore while we're doing this. Come around here. That face there, that face, and that face. We're not going to worry about the other side right now, just because you'll get the idea from me just doing this side here. So you select all the faces you want to offset, you accept that, and then basically it wants to know what direction you want to offset. Well, we're going to be adding material, so we need a point away from our part, and it wants to know what distance. So, as I said, our foundry told us we want to add 3/16 material. So we're going to go 3/16 in there, accept it. As you'll see, our part grew there. And just to show you, we'll put a dimension here on this inside bore right now. Is it 9 5/8? Now if I come back to before that offset face, just do a go to, delete that dimension, that's not pointing to anything anymore. And we'll take a dimension from that same bore, you'll notice that it's 10 inches. So by adding the 3/16, you have to remember the diameter, it's adding 3/16 on both sides, so it's actually adding 3/8. So we see the difference that it actually added 3/8 material to that inside bore. And it did the same for all those other faces. So it's a really quick way to add all the stock and things like that to your parts by just using offset face. Next thing we're gonna go over here is on how to use a family of parts. So I've got my casting here that's all done. It's got my stock added to it. Pretty rough there. I haven't added any radiuses or anything like that to just make a nice simple casting here. And basically, well, we found out that this casting is going to make both a 10-inch bore diameter and a 10.5-inch bore diameter casting with a different set of cores for it. Well, instead of making the two part files, and then having to go back and update it when I've had the time to actually do the rounding and things like that to it, I'm just gonna come over here to the family of parts tree. And first thing we're gonna do is just go to edit table. You'll see when you come in here first, it's blank. Now this from experience, the first thing I suggest doing is create a new member, and we're just gonna call this one cast, and then I give it a generic or something like that. What that does is it makes a family of part member that captures the design intent of your model at that time. Because if you don't have a family member that has your current design intent, when you apply all the settings for the other family members, you can't go back to that original design intent unless you had an original member to go with. So that allows us to always create one which we can then use to create drawing views that we know is going to be coming from a static set of geometry that's not going to move and change and blow up our drawing views that are created from that family of parts. So that's one of the main reasons we utilize a generic with all of our family of parts, just so that we can go back to what our original design intent was. Then after creating that, we're going to go through and we're going to say, okay, we've got a cast 10-inch bore, and we have a cast 10.5-inch bore. So as you see here, it creates columns for each one of those, and then it also gives you a path to where that part's going to be created. And basically it puts the, by default, those parts into the same folder in which your parent part's located at. So if you want to, you can change the paths there to point them to different folders for those parts. That's up to your design standards and things like that within your company. You'll notice here the status is blank. This will change from several different icons. The help file is very helpful on that because you might come up with icons that you haven't seen before but the majority of them are like a red question mark, which means there's some type of error. You have a little hourglass that basically shows it's out of date, and then you have just the link symbol that means it's linked, created to the part, and everything's okay. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna take through here, and the only difference is, in these models, is basically this bore diameter variable is going to change between each one of those different members. So I'm going to type in 10.5 inch there, and you'll see it automatically populates the rest of that row with what the original value was. So I mean, it, because of the fact that I designed it as a 10 inch there, I'm not going to have to change my 10 inch board. So we're going to have two parts that are the same. But if I were to later come back and change other things within there, I can still maintain my original design within. So once you've created the variables that you want to change, and all I did is when I placed that dimension, I renamed the variable to bore diameter, just so I can find it easier in the variable tables when I'm looking there. Otherwise, you have to remember the whatever number and make it harder to find. So all you need to do is, after you've populated everything in the table, is select all your members, and you'll populate your members. And we'll hit OK to save our file. And it wants to know if we can populate three members. And as you notice there, it's creating new files as we're sitting here watching. So now that it's done, we have three new part files. Hit OK there. And if we were to open up one of these part files that it created, you'll notice that all it is in your family tree is a part copy back to that family of parts. So there's nothing you have to actually worry about in each one of those family of parts members. So all you do is when you make changes is you go back and repopulate your parts, and it has all the changes for you in those models. And so you just have to change it in one location. So we showed how to do that real quick with a casting by just having two bores. Well, you see here I have a part copy and bunch of machining features on this casting. Well, we found out, we have two different bolting patterns that we need for connecting to the guide that the cylinder is going to go on. One of them looks like that, which is missing four holes, and the other one looks like that, which has four extra holes in it. Well, it's simple enough that, okay, we'll save two copies of part files, delete out that hole. Well, the problem comes in is, well, what if we have to come up here and change some of the other standard machining on this part and want it to be across both? Well, that makes you have to do it twice. So instead, we'll do the same thing. We're going to go to family of parts, edit table, and we're going to create a new member. And I'm going to do the same thing here, do a machine generic so I can capture my design intent. And then we're just going to go machine one, machine two. Basically, when you're working on this in your design environment, you'll probably want to use actual part numbers from your system that you want to name these as. For this demonstration purposes, I'm just giving it a unique name there.
Why do you not do your machine casting in the same family of parts?
Because I'll show you that when I do the part copy. So what I wanted to show here is the fact that this hole 113, I want in machine two, I want those holes to be suppressed. And basically, with suppressing and unsuppressing features, you do not have to actually tell it to be unsuppressed. It by default is unsuppressed within the tree here. So you can come through and tell it unsuppressed on both of those, but it'll actually blame back out to be empty once you populate the parts. So the only value you truly need to see is suppress here. So this shows that you can use both suppress, or you can also use diameter variables to change your family of parts. And then you do the same thing here, populate members and go through that way. Now the reason we don't do a family of parts off of our casting is what you could, but then that becomes the fact that you have to worry about all the features in the one file, and then you have a lot of stuff you would suppress, populate it that way. Whereas what we're going to show here is I want to start working on the machining. So I'm going to start a new part file. What I'll do is I'll build part copy, and I'm going to bring in my casting. which I can either say, well, I'm going to work with the 10.5-inch bore casting. So, I mean, if you could have different machinings based upon different castings, so you can have a lot of different base parts you're coming from that'll have different machining in it. So it really helps to segregate what geometry you're working on. That's one of the reasons we like doing this, is it helps to separate your design intent, so you're not changing something and then have it go back and affect your machining.
What's always aggravated me is you know what your final part wants to look like.
Yes.
So you're saying that you create it first, and then you go back and add offset faces.
Well, see, what you do is you create your final machine faces. We don't add any holes into it. Then we do the offset faces to show the stock, because that's what we need to send it. Because some of our pattern makers now actually do with CNC machining and take our models to create their patterns from. So by that, then we come in here and have a machine model, have it linked to the casting, and then we start doing our machine faces there, which is slightly different, because what we do for our bore is not the same as what we go to our casting, because it has multiple steps in the bore, but when it goes to the foundry, it's only one bore. So you can have multiple sessions or multiple parts open side by side a lot of the time. So what you'll do when you're designing it is have both switch back and forth on it. Well, that's the part copy. That's because of the family of parts. But what, because we don't usually have our family of parts at the beginning when we're designing it, and you switch back and forth, and as you make your changes in your casting and switch back over to your machining window, you can have it set to automatically update so that your changes go back and forth, and so you see your machine changes and casting changes. So you're basically designing in two parts at the same time when you're doing it. So it's one way to do it. I mean, there's some benefits to doing it in one file, and there's other benefits to do it in a single file and new family of parts for it, too, like you were suggesting.
So you have a part copy of the casting,
mm-hmm.
and then you have a sequence of cuts.
Yes.
Do you do those in the operation order, or just randomly?
It depends on what you're wanting to do. We don't usually do them in an exact sequence. We try to model the cuts just like they would be done out in the machine shop. So we don't know for sure which order, because sometimes, depending on the cells they're going to, they may be machined in a different order. So, but they'll be doing the same cuts on the final model, if you understand.
Graphics in your MOTs, travelers.
We have our drawings within it. We don't actually show the different steps at that point. So we have a final drawing, and then they have the routings, which are written steps on which processes they do first. But yes, if you did have graphics, that would be a good way to do it in order. So that way you could have even multiple part copies where you do the first machining here, save it, open up, create a new part copy, and do it. So that way you have multiple draft files. You can have multiple part files to create your draft files off of it to show the different steps of the machine.
You just roll it back to a given operation.
Correct. But if they're actually wanting to have a link to the live model, that's something that you can think about, is using part numbers. So basically, just to show this, is basically at this point, we're going to just do quick cut. Okay. Quick cut, because we're running out of time. And do this pad here.
back-to-back into a break session, not to say go along, but since we started 15 minutes late, just know that.
Okay.
And anybody who wants to step out for your break at 3:30, feel free, but if he's got material, it's up to you.
So basically, I'm just going to do a quick cut here and do a actual finite extent on front two, and we're just going to go 360s now. So we're milling into that pad. It's not a clean profile because I didn't mention it here, just for the sake of brevity. And it's going to show by the point of going back to our model, and I start adding my rounds into this. So we're going to add a 1-inch round in between there. And when we come back to our machining and update it, you'll notice that it actually goes through and cuts part of that round, which it didn't like showing that. Working on my test model, which is, but I can tell you that it will. Oh, I know why. I'm sorry, I did that wrong. I know why it's not working. Is we'll go here, parallel plane. I did it backwards, and I wanted to take the plane from the center, or here, take it down below. And then when I did the direction on my cut, see, it doesn't pay to hurry, because when you start hurrying, you make mistakes. Mm-hmm. And we're just going to go through next until they go up. And see, by doing it that way, then when we add material to that part, it's going to actually cut through all that new material and rounds and stuff that we added there. So allows us to make changes to the casting that might not necessarily require us to actually make any changes to our machining model, except we're actually updating. So it saves on time of having to go through and update two models if you had a separate casting model and a separate machining model. And show quickly on assembly features. Basically, to show here is I'm going to create a new assembly. And I'm going to save that assembly to here. Basically, I have this connecting rod. I had the base connecting rod, which was the rough forging, and then I had the connecting rod, which has the machining done to it when it's done in a single part state. So what I'll do is I'll bring in first copy of that for creating the cap, and then what I'll do is I'll bring in a second copy of that same part, and I'm going to make it concentric to that board, this face there, and then lock the rotation based on that flap there.
Are you adding material for the curve of the saw when you saw that or cut it?
Yes.
You're adding material ahead of time?
Yes. Basically what it is because we're going to be cutting this, there's extra material in between the board. So there's a flap there, and what we have to do is that's why we can't do this in a multi-body part, is because we have two circles here that we want to be concentric at the end, so we need to move it over to be concentric with that. Yeah. So that's why we're not just doing a split within a multi-body. So basically we brought this in, and then what we're going to do is utilize underneath the features, the cuts, and we're going to use assembly features, which basically the difference is assembly-driven perk features have the profile and stuff created inside the assembly file, but the cut itself is pushed to the part file. But an assembly feature, the profile and the cut itself maintains itself only within the assembly, so it has no effect on the actual part file. So what we do is come over here, and we're going to take and do an open profile like I've been doing. Turn off my base planes. And I'm just going to connect the midpoint of that, close my sketch. I want to cut this way first to make my cap. I'm going to tell it to cut through all this direction. Then it wants to know what parts I want to cut. Well, I don't want to cut both of them, or otherwise I'd be in, there'd be no benefit of doing it this way. So what we're going to do is only cut the first one. Notice there that now we have a cut line there, and if I turn off the second part, we just have the cap there. And if we turn on the second part, we still have the full part. So by doing this, then I created a second cut, because you can't cut two directions at the same time and select different parts to cut, which would be a nice feature for doing something like this. But it hasn't been something that's used often enough that we've been able to justify getting that done as an enhancement request, because we only have so many of these parts, and it's only one added step, so it's not as much of a benefit for us. But if somebody out there does have a need for it, put an enhancement request in, feel free to let us know, and we'll sign on to it also, because we could use it. And what we'll do is this time cut the other direction and do a through all again. Go both directions. And this time we're going to remove the first part. So as you'll see now, I have a cap and the rod. But what this allows me to do now is as I can come here, do an assembly feature. This plane, and tell it the final bore diameter that's going to be cut through here once they're, because they're actually going to be machined at this point separate, put the vise together so we're cutting the bore at the same time, and we'll give that, say, 8-inch bore. Then what we'll do is do a through all both directions, and we're going to cut both parts this time. So this way we can change that part there like that. And what this allows us to do now is when we go back, let me add one more thing to that cutout to better demonstrate what I'm about to do. And we're going to do the final machining of this down here. Turn on our pure edge locate. Which I'm not sure if everybody knows, pure edge locate allows you to locate assembly parts within an assembly by using your intersection endpoints and things like that. If your pure edge locate isn't on, you won't be able to actually work with any of the parts in your assembly. By default, I keep it off because there's a bunch of extra lines and stuff you have to work with, and then I just turn it on when I need to work with. We've added that to our main home screen so we can easily turn it on and off. And then what we'll do here is put a quick dimension on here. And want that at 6.5 inches. Okay. So what I can do now is if I go clear back to this and open up my Conrod, and I open up my part copy, clear back to the base forging, and they've decided, well, we need to adjust this so that instead of being 17.25, it needs to be 17.5 inches. So we can change that there, go straight to our assembly. If you hit go to tools and update all lengths, It will go through and update your part copy within your intermediate step and update everything here. So you saw where that machine information has changed through three steps of parts and changed these final bore machines to be 17 and a half inches apart instead of 17 and a quarter. And just to verify that, I'll pull a quick PMI. You'll see it's at 17 and a half. You can do holes that go through multiple parts, so that if you have a tapped hole that's done when they're separate, that actually taps through both holes and then it's bolted together, you can do those within an assembly also, do chamfers and things like that. So you can basically machine your part within the assembly environment. That way you can create your detail drawing from that assembly to show both of the parts when they're machined separate. So basically that's the shortened version of some of my demonstrations, but it's basically what I had there for this. And